news.va.gov/outreach/radio.
The fact that our patriotism in America is dwindling, I really wanted to start the American AF movement. Freedom is fragile, very fragile. It takes a certain level of intestinal fortitude to stand up and say and do the right thing to preserve the freedoms that so many have paid a large price for.
American tactical. American as f***.
Welcome to NBR Red Friday, where we welcome all the troops that come home. We want all our troops that deployed downrange to come home. I'm here with Black Sugar Show, The Reveille Show, and your show,
HGTV Sports in the Cave.
Sports in the Cave. So join us every Friday to every troop comes home on NBR. Give Betis a voice.
You going back in?
There's still men out there.
God damn.
When I go home, people ask me, "Hey, Hoot, why do you do it, man? Why? You're some kind of war junkie?" I won't say a goddamn word. Why? They won't understand. They won't understand why we do it. They won't understand it's about the men next to you. And that's it. That's all it is.
Find us on the web at mbradio.us.
I want to make it clear that the views expressed by our hosts are not considered the official stance of MBR Views. Remember, this is all about having fun and enjoying the ride.
We're trying to make dreams come true.
Well, they supported us now. It's our turn to support them.
The Reveille Experience. Get experience.
Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to the Reveille Experience. This is V Squared in the house. I've got CG with me today with her whole clan. We've got the commander in chief here. And we got H-Train kind of looming in the background. We got Mercury and Caveman working the
full
sound.
Full house this morning.
Yeah, full house this morning. So weather's been beautiful. Oh my goodness. You know, I'm a kind of an all year round sports guy, but it's probably time to hang up the skis, you know, pretty much. Yeah. Got a couple more trips planned, but I've been playing golf. I've been riding my bike. It's time to transition. I guess the Punxsutawney Phil was correct because they said early spring. Yeah. So I know a lot of people like that type of weather. I'm sure you guys.
Spring's the best.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
What do you like about it?
Mating, just kidding. No, I was thinking about the bees, you know, yeah. Birds and the bees. No, I just, it's like, it's not too hot. It's just, it's really fresh, you know, and then everything starts getting green.
Yeah.
So it's just, you know, it's like a rebirth type thing.
It is. It is, yeah. Exciting time of the year.
Wash away all the ugly sticks and trees and dirty snow.
Right. You know, and I took a bonsai class last fall through the VA, and
Nice to make the little trees.
Yeah, the little trees, and I brought it home. It was beautiful. I had foliage, beautiful tree. And then, you know, the fall came and started losing leaves. They turned yellow, and I thought I was killing it. I thought I was dying. And I was thinking, and my wife and I are like, "What's wrong with it?" So then I did research and I found out, oh, they go into dormancy, like, you know, a lot of trees.
Yeah.
So now it's just beautiful, dude. It's got these huge, huge leaves, and it's starting to, you know, like you said. So it's like, we call it Bonnie because of bonsai. So Bonnie's not dead. She's going to make it. She pulled out of her coma. Oh, she's going to make it.
You know, I was living in South Carolina for like a year, and so I got all the seasons, you know, which is only like two, but still. the spring was crazy because it literally, you have about an inch of pollen on your car.
Wow. Dang.
Yeah. So if you have allergies, you're effed, you know, because.
Yeah, that sucks.
Yeah, but I thought it was neat. I was like, what is this stuff? I was amazed by it because I'd never seen that before. Yeah. You know, you vacation places, but you're only there for a certain amount of time. So you're not there for all the seasons.
That's true. That's true.
Never got to see that before. So yeah, you had to turn your windshield wipers on, and like, that's how bad it was. It's crazy.
That's crazy. And what city was this again?
Beaufort, South Carolina.
Beaufort.
Yeah, it's actually right across the street from Paris Island Boot Camp.
Oh, okay. Marines, yeah, Charleston was my last duty station.
Oh,
so,
really?
Yeah,
nice.
I was actually there when Hurricane Hugo hit.
Oh, okay. Oh,
back in '89, yeah.
Man, those streets in Charleston, they fill up with water quick.
Oh man, yeah, dude, it's just bad. crazy. It was a crazy time, but that base has since been closed,
so. Oh really?
Yeah, it's not
that's a nice place there. To be stationed though. Nice.
Yeah,
it's coastal. It's really beautiful.
Yeah, I think that all the submarines that were stationed out of that post were probably moved to Virginia, I'm thinking. Yeah,
there's a lot of bases over on the East Coast.
There is a lot over there on the East Coast, you know.
Yeah.
All and up and down. You know, they have Kings Bay in Georgia. That's the Trident, the big boomers. That's their post, and then of course you got a bunch of other services that have bases out there. And the good old days. When I got out, I was working on my undergrad, and I had taken this class. It was a core class. So I needed it. And so it was like another 2-3 months after my discharge. So I met this guy. I don't remember where, but I met this guy, and he lived downtown Charleston. And I said, dude, I need a room, you know. This place was a rat hole. I mean, it was disgusting, but it was like, it was cool. Like you said, living downtown, really a lot of culture, you know, those old colonial homes down there.
Yeah. They're really neat.
Beautiful.
Rainbow Road.
Yeah. Rainbow Road. And so, yeah, it was a fun couple months, you know.
There was one time I went down to Charleston because I had to go to the VA there because there wasn't one in Beaufort. So it was about an hour and a half away. I actually had my baby in Charleston.
All right.
Yeah. He's a Charleston baby. But yeah, there was one time it was like a bad dream. I had to go to the bathroom so bad. I had to pee. And Charleston's like a little island. So, you know, yeah. I mean, you live there, you know. I kept for two times in a row that I went there, I ended up going to the same ghetto gas station. Like I couldn't find another one. And I was like, it made me like, get me out of here. I just want to go to this stupid gas station again. Yeah. But it was the only one I could ever find.
Am I in the Twilight Zone here?
Yeah, exactly. That's what I felt.
Yeah, so good times, good memories. You know, I would love to go. I have a friend that just recently moved to North Carolina, and he's invited me down for, like, you know, a visit, golf vacation or whatever. And I'm like, maybe I'll trek down to South Carolina, check it out.
Yeah.
On there.
Yeah, it'd be nice to go back and see where, you know, memories, right?
Yeah, you know, we went to San Diego. I was stationed in San Diego.
I was stationed in San Diego as well. Yeah.
2019, we went there for family vacation. I'm like, oh yeah, I'm going to show you guys around. I know all about this.
You didn't know
I was so lost. I was like, this has changed so much.
I'm glad you said that because I would have done the same thing. Yeah. Oh, I used to live, but that was like 20 years ago. So.
And my grandkids are like, Bumpo, I thought you said you lived there. You know the city. And I'm like, I'm sorry.
The honest kids.
Lost.
They always. call you out, right?
Yeah, I'm lost. Bumpo's worthless. He can't. He doesn't know. You know which way is up. So we're just gonna have a good time and explore. And we made the big mistake of driving. Oh, that was horrible.
Oh gosh, horrible. Yeah. This traffic is so bad.
What we were thinking? Oh, we'll drive. It's cheaper. Mm-hmm. Please.
Unless yeah, there's like really no time. Yeah.
I don't want to drive. I'd rather just fly.
Yeah. Well, when you get
I think it took us 19 hours to get there and 21 hours to get home. I was miserable.
Yeah, I did that drive twice because I had to move. I moved from San Diego to back to Denver.
Oh, yeah?
After I got out, yeah.
Wow.
So we drove there with my car and then had to drive back. And my girlfriend that I drove with, she was a Marine as well, and she got out the same time. We went to boot camp together. So we drove together. But the catch was she didn't know how to drive a stick shift. So I had to drive the whole way.
Wow.
Yeah.
That's a long haul.
She owes me.
She owes you. Do you guys still stay in touch?
Yeah. Yeah. That's she lives in Chicago. She kept going after, obviously.
And when did you get out?
2003.
So that was a while ago. Yeah. I had one, like my best friend in the military, and the last couple of years, he's just been real distant. So I'm like, I don't want to, I'll just leave, you know, let it be because for some whatever reason he's not responding to my emails or phone calls. So I'm like, okay, well,
yeah, you know,
it was nice while it lasted.
Yeah, which was like a long time, like 30 years, right?
Yeah, I got out in 90. So
yeah, so you never know what's going on.
You really don't, you know, and you can't take that stuff personal. I mean, he could be going through some stuff, and
exactly.
I want to respect his privacy, so I figure he'll reach out when he's ready.
Well, I mean, that's like a lot of things. They check on your battle buddies, right?
Yeah, you know, and that's kind of like what we do here.
Yeah.
Because, you know, we're checking on our battle buddies. We're getting information out.
Finding
resources for them. Joel and I were talking about doing some more homeless stuff.
Nice.
LGBTQT. Did I say that right?
I don't know.
I think so.
I think they added a couple more letters.
So, you know, we're reaching out to some different
LBT whatever squared like you
squared some different groups and trying to address their needs and support them any way we can because they deserve it. We're all veterans, and another thing that Joel and I kind of, I don't know if he's on board with this, but I kind of forced it on him, but he has giving veterans a voice, and then mine was empowering veterans from all walks of life. So I kind of married the two and empowering veterans from all walks of life by giving veterans a voice. So that's kind of like our new tagline.
Yeah.
You know, like, and we really want to take that to heart and make that happen. Not just be, a bunch of words come out of my mouth, but we really want to, take that to heart and really give it the old college try to help. I did we went up to Winter Park on Tuesday, and are you familiar with Valor Point?
Mm-mm.
It's a treatment facility for vets.
Oh, okay. In the mountains.
It's in Golden, I think.
Okay.
Golden or Lakewood, one of those. Anyway, there was about six veterans that were on that came from there with us. And man, it was just fascinating to talk to these guys that had experienced homelessness, obviously they had addictions, and they were just so determined to better their lives. And I thought, man, we need to collaborate with these guys. I was telling them about the podcast, and they were like, a couple more were like, man, dude, I want to be on that show. I want to get the word out. And so kind of a little light bulb went off in my head. I'm like, man, we need to collaborate with these guys and do what we can just to help, give them resources, like you said, maybe housing resources, or help them get their VA benefits or food stamps, any kind of state assistance.
Yeah. They have a bunch of programs that are available that it's just takes going there to figure it out. But like,
it really does.
Like the VA actually has like a, they have food banks.
Yes.
They have. The VA has one where they give you your disabled vet or just vet, I think. Low income, they give you a thing of food at the beginning of the month.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
I didn't know that.
Yeah.
I had no idea. We need to talk about that for sure. Cause that's another good thing that I think you know, like you said, I mean, you're going to have to jump through hoops. You're going to have to fill out paper. You're going to have to follow up. You know, there is some work that you have to do. But in my opinion, they're highly underutilized. They're not, you know, and people, you know, even people that know about it, you know, I don't feel like they utilize them enough.
So. Yeah, exactly. And I went to the VA yesterday, which was really, it was a nice visit. Like,
That's odd.
Yeah, I know. I was like excited to tell you guys. It was like really nice. I brought my son and, you know, he's just barely about to walk. He's going to be one. And I took him out of his little stroller and he just crawled all around. They actually, some guy, he was like hitting on the glass window and the guy was in a meeting and he come out. But he was so nice and brought him toys. And I was like, the VA has toys?
Right?
Why didn't I get a toy?
I was expecting that. I was expecting an ass chewing, you know?
And yeah. Exactly.
He brought my son toys.
Yeah, but Jack, it was cool.
Good morning, Team Rebel.
Oh, good morning.
All right.
Jack from YouTube.
Welcome I think in. that could be my friend from South Carolina. Yeah, so it was a nice experience. The baby just crawled, played with the toy. He went up to everybody. And I think it made them feel good, you know, bring a baby around because it was a lot of older people because it's a disabled vet area. Mm-hmm. Yeah. So they were, I think he made a couple people's day, you know, just by smiling.
Always. Yeah. Yesterday we dropped off our granddaughter at school and I showed you the new addition. So we have this new little, it's not a teacup. It's just a mini poodle. Her name is Chiquita. And she wanted to carry the dog to her classroom. So she's walking across the curtain to her class. She's like, I got a new baby. I got a new baby. She's brand new. Oh, and I was like, oh my God, this little girl's a character.
Oh,
man.
Wow. And how old is she?
She's six.
Oh, goodness.
She's just letting everybody know her new baby.
Oh, that's so sweet.
Yeah, it was awesome. So, hey, we're coming up on our first break. When we come back, we're going to do What the Moment, I believe. Stay tuned, folks. Got lots coming on. We got a great guest this morning and lots more to talk about. We'll see you in a minute.
Take the cosmic ride again. turn me back in stardust. Forge me into the light. Fractured into 100 billion atoms. And I'll fade back into the night. I'll fade back into the night. And I'll fade back into the night. And I'll fade back into the night.
Welcome back, folks. Welcome back. I'm sorry, I kind of got caught with my pants down there a minute. we were
talking about the artist.
Yeah, we were engrossed in a very meaningful conversation. So I apologize. Yes. So, anyways, welcome back. Again, we're gonna go right into our what the moment.
It's a cool cast, man.
Oh, for real. Thank you, bro. You see the cobra?
Yeah, what is this one?
Oh, this? Uh-huh. That's my credo. No regrets. Mm-hmm.
You have no regrets?
Dad?
No.
Like, not even a single letter?
No way. Not me.
Well, I love him. I think he's great. Okay. I think he's a real winner, Casey. If I were you, I wouldn't use protection.
Rolling on the floor, laughing.
Oh, okay. Oh. I'm old, dude. I'm old. I had to have a guy explain to me what MILF was a couple years ago. Anyway,
what the segment? H Train probably can explain this story better. But there was an Army veteran. This happened in 2021. But he married conjoined twin sisters that were on like a reality TV show.
Now coming up.
I don't know. It might have just resurfaced or something.
Yeah, it resurfaced because that happened in 2021. That's crazy.
But they were a part of like a TV show that like documented their life pretty much. Like it was like TLC where they have all this really
like a Lifetime
shows.
Type thing.
Yeah. It's like the My Strange Addiction show.
Oh, yeah. Where they eat toilet paper.
Yeah.
And
weird stuff like that.
Collect toenails.
Or the people that have like 10 kids.
Yeah. Those huge family shows.
Yeah.
But it was like one of those. But it just documented their life. And I think it was the final season that ended off with their like wedding or whatever. But yeah, that was back in 2021. Mm. I always just wanted to.
So, are they considered
a thoughts on that?
Yeah, is it considered a throuple?
I don't know.
Yeah, what is that?
Like, this guy, are they always having a threesome?
Yeah,
and he married both of them.
It said that he only married one.
Okay,
but technically both of them because
can't
really do otherwise. They're like connected at the neck, so it's one body, but they it's like two different.
Gosh, heads crazy. There's crazy. Just so much I want to say.
Yeah,
that I can't.
That's inappropriate.
Say. Yeah, like literally, I gotta just get a different show to talk about this.
Yeah, well, you know, back in the day, I don't remember their names, but there was a set of Siamese twins that married sisters, and they were in the Guinness Book of World Records because they had like these ungodly amount of kids.
Oh,
both
really?
Of them, like 12 and 15 and. So I'd always wonder, like, wow, what do they do? Like maybe put a sheet up, like, hey, you guys do your thing, and we'll try to put our headphones on or whatever, and we're, you know, we don't want to ruin the mood for you. But yeah, they fathered these huge families, and
it's so nuts.
It was just crazy that, you know, two brothers married two sisters, and they had these big families, and they were famous. They got into Guinness Book of World Records.
Yeah. I don't think there's a category for that.
Yeah. I hope not.
They had to invent a new one.
Yeah, exactly. Pornhub's like, oh, shit.
Mark, you're always looking for new money.
How do we top that?
Yeah, he's like, should we name it? I don't even know.
Marketing department's gonna have to step up.
Yeah,
I know.
Come on, guys.
Got your work cut out for you, buddy. Oh my goodness. Two-sided
pamphlets.
She's on one today, H. She is on one today. We're loving it.
It's a perfect story, though. Yeah, honestly. Right. But yeah. it is relevant to MBR because he was an Army veteran, I guess, the guy that married her.
Oh, that's awesome.
Yeah.
Well, thank you for your service, sir.
Yeah.
More ways than one.
Yeah.
More ways than one.
Anyway, so and I take it they're still married?
Yeah, I think so, yeah.
Have they started a family or
I'm not sure. It said that they're school teachers. So the two sisters.
Oh, really?
Obviously, they teach the same class.
One's the teacher. One's the teacher assistant. No.
Yeah, the assistant.
You guys are horrible.
That's got to be a tough teacher to have, you know, because like, well, one's teaching, the other one's scanning the class.
Oh, yeah. You can't finding cheat people or passing notes.
Oh, if you're cheating, no, they're on it.
They're on it. They're on
it. It's like. Yeah. That's actually
I'd be like, oh, I don't like the left one.
Yeah. She's always hard on me. She's so mean.
Exactly.
She never has anything nice to say. Yeah.
That's just I don't even
that's interesting that they're teachers. Wow.
Yeah, like I wouldn't even be able to pay attention to class.
I'm sure I bet they're really popular.
I'd still just be trying to figure out.
You're like you probably wouldn't be able to like teach really young kids. Unless that probably is what they teach.
Well, yeah. And can you imagine what like unfiltered children would say?
That's why it would be really hard.
They can be cruel. I mean, I'm a retired educator.
That's why I'm having a hard time with this concept because I'm an unfiltered child.
Exactly.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, that's kind of the way of the law of the land is pretty much being unfiltered, you know?
Mm-hmm.
And it's ironic because what do we do when when people take pictures? They use filters.
Yeah, exactly.
True.
So yeah, that was a great segment. Funny. What do we got next, fellas?
Well, these new MLB stadiums came out with a bunch of new food. So we got a picture of a few of them here. I kind of just want to hear your opinions on it. Just let people know if you would even actually spend your money on it, and the viewers too. You can go ahead and.
You should tell us how much it is too, because those things are like $30.
When I go to like the Coors Field, I always go to the Buckaroo Kids.
Is it
exactly?
Oh, really? Is that what that is? Oh, that's cool.
Yeah.
Is it like just a kids area?
It's a kids area. And they're like, stuff was cheap, you know.
It has like a whole playground and everything.
Oh,
yeah.
Wow.
Yeah. Okay.
So, now I want to go.
See, it doesn't show the prices, but here's some of the new stuff at Coors Field. The barbecue chicken and mac and cheese sandwich.
Huh.
Green chili cheese fries. Steak empanadas. That sounds
pretty good. That sounds really good.
Doritos walking tacos.
Huh. Oh, okay, yeah, I've had those before. Those are pretty good.
Those are really good. Stuffed tater kegs.
What?
Huh.
Stuffed tater tots with boom boom sauce.
Okay. Sold.
We used to have a boom boom room, but I don't know.
That you take the sauce in the room.
These large.
Ironically, that's next to the baby changing station.
Got the. Let's see. What are these? What's it called again?
It's like ice cream. The berry
waffle
cone.
That's what it's called. But it's just an ice cream cone there. Berries on top. They got this s'mores shake. I mean, these are honestly really good. Yeah. The Rockies lost opening day 16-1. So watching them lose that bad, this might soften up.
Yeah, that might soften up
quite a bit.
We talked earlier about allegiance to teams and stuff, and I'm a big Rockies fan, but it is getting really depressing.
They need to sell the team.
They didn't even sign anyone good in the offseason. They didn't really do anything.
I just don't understand. I mean, it's been abysmal for how many years now? It's just ridiculous.
They might be like the worst franchise in MLB history. They're just so mismanaged. It's
oh my goodness, it's so terrible. Sad.
And then it's funny. They're one of the few sports teams around here where you can actually watch them play. You know, because they're on like ESPN and like on the MLB channels that aren't blacked out.
Mm-hmm.
But then you got Altitude Sports around here that which carries, you know, the championship winning basketball team, championship caliber hockey team, and championship caliber lacrosse team as well.
Yeah,
it makes sense. Can't watch any of those. It makes sense that the Rockies are the easiest to watch then.
Yeah, it makes sense, and that there's always tickets available.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, you can watch the Rockies lose and the Broncos suck, but
yeah,
can't watch any of your good sports teams.
Yeah,
that's where they draw. That's where they draw the line.
That's where they draw the line. We're not going to allow you access to that stuff.
The White Sox, they unveiled some pretty good stuff. This campfire milkshake. That's why I pulled.
Oh my goodness, look at that thing.
Looks amazing, honestly, but that's probably so expensive.
Looks like you could eat the cup.
Yeah, I was going to say, is that cup edible? I mean, holy cow.
That's Chicago, right?
Yeah.
Yes.
All right,
Chicago's that good,
maybe
dude.
Taking a road trip to Chicago again.
You could do a trip to Chicago and do a foodie trip for sure. They have the best food there.
My friend that I went played golf with at the indoor league last night, he's going to Chicago. His birthday's on the 4th, I believe. He's flying out the morning of the 3rd, the evening of the 2nd. I can't remember what he said, but he's going to Wrigley Field to watch the Rockies play.
Oh, wow.
Wrigley, is that Cubbies?
Yeah, Cubs. Yeah, I think so. I went to one game when I went there too.
Yeah, so I was like, that's pretty cool birthday present.
Yeah,
yeah. So
when you could have got the ticket for $5 here in Denver.
Yeah, that's true. Go on VetTix and get them for like really cheap.
Oh yeah,
I think the processing fee is more than the ticket.
Right. So,
I'm not sure if that's a good deal or not.
Now let me know what you guys think about this Kansas City Royals. Their blue burger.
Ooh,
looks like the pretty patty.
Yeah, that looks disgusting.
Yeah.
Sorry.
It looks really
gross. Is that blue cheese too?
I think so.
It looks like don't Google the blue waffle, right?
Yeah, they pretty good choice choosing the burger. That does not look good.
We gotta pull up the funnel cake sundae.
That looks good.
You know, it's refreshing to see that all this stuff's heart healthy and
classic stadium
This is like peak America.
Wow, look at that. Is that a hot dog?
Let's see what that one's called.
That's Baltimore.
The Orioles. I think that one is called the Warehouse Dog. Yep.
Warehouse.
I mean, it doesn't get more American than this. Baseball and incredibly unhealthy food.
That could be a contender against a Chicago D or a Dodger Dog or.
This stuff would put a European in a coma.
Oh yeah, for sure. Yeah, they give them diabetes immediately.
Yeah, those look pretty decadent.
Wow.
The Yankees also got those shakes. There's in such fancy glasses, too.
I know. Are those glass?
They're probably not glass.
Well, that's probably not.
They're probably plastic. Huh?
Yeah. They try to.
I think that's a ho-ho right there on the corner.
It looks like one.
A lot of these photos, they put them in fancy.
On the other side, like a Twix.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Put them in fancy glasses on fancy plates. Like you get this at the stadium, they're gonna throw it in like a plastic cup or
it's gonna
be in like one of those little like cardboard or paper trays.
Yeah. Yeah.
It's gonna look a lot more, and then there's a huge line of people, so they're not gonna present it nicely. It's just gonna get slopped on there.
Like that blue burger. I can't imagine ordering that at an actual game. Like no. There's these cookie egg rolls. This is the New York Mets. Just like a fried cookie, pretty much.
Huh.
Those honestly look pretty good too.
I was gonna say they're probably pretty delicious. Pretty good.
Also on the website is this
HTX tacos.
Foot long pennant dog. This is with the Astros, and this is a new restaurant they're opening in the stadium. I think they got bought out.
That makes sense.
Houston Astros Stadium is Minute Maid Stadium. Now, so I don't know if that was recently bought out by that company and they're kind of like revamping it, but there's so much new stuff. Chopped cheese, this Bronx burrito. The Chicago Guardians had probably the grossest one. There were hot dogs with mac and cheese, they had bacon bits, and then they topped it off.
Cleveland Guardians, right?
Yeah, they topped it off with Fruit Loops.
Ew.
and hot Cheeto fries.
Why?
I have honestly no idea. The hot Cheeto fries kind of make sense.
Yeah, the Cheetos make sense.
But why Fruit Loops?
Well, you know, you talk about a club that struggled. I mean, how many years did they struggle before they became another viable opponent? I mean, they'd had a long dry streak.
They were really bad.
You know, so hopefully, I mean, I would hate to see the Rockies leave. I mean, you know, they're part of our, you know, fabric of our city, but, you know, HG, you might be right. I don't know what the answer is.
They don't have to move. They just need new ownership to take over. Like, if selling the team, like, because they're owned by some millionaire or, he's not even like a billionaire. That's how bad the Rockies are. Like, there are current MLB teams that their value is almost as much as this guy's net worth. So it's, they just need new ownership and
need a baseball guy, not a millionaire.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, that's what they said about the Broncos. Look what happened there.
True.
That new family has just made a.
Yeah, the Walmart family bought us.
Yeah, the Walmart family. So, whatever.
No, see, Rangers. If you sell the team, I don't think you move the Rockies. I mean, like, it's a great Coors Field's a great stadium. It's in a great location.
It's a great city.
And like, the way it's built, like, you get an amazing view of the mountains.
Yeah, the front range.
So, like, you just need somebody that is going to hire the right people and make the right, you know, ownership decisions to push the team in the right direction, because this just been the same old thing year after year.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
The Rangers, the previous World Series winner, they hired Scooby-Doo and Shaggy as their marketing for this new food thing, because this sandwich is gigantic.
Yes.
The onion ring, that you can wear that as like a necklace.
Oh, wow.
Giant onion rings. I don't know how you can eat this and like watch baseball at the same time. The brisket croissant, that actually makes sense. That's something you can hold in your hand.
Very Texan.
Yeah.
What else we got here with the Blue Jays? Well, with the poutine hot dog, that's $9.99 Canadian dollars.
That almost looks like the most normal looking thing.
Yeah, it's not oversized. It's just a regular hot dog.
Normal sized hot dog. Oh, this is just
glazed donut incredibly topped with popcorn, courtesy of Sunday Donuts. This is a milkshake with two donuts on it, a bunch of popcorn, sprinkles, and frosting.
I can just feel my arteries clogging.
I can feel my teeth like
falling out.
Yeah.
Popcorn kernel stuck in there.
Yeah.
And the White Sox, they must have spent all their money marketing or spending all their money making that s'mores milkshake, because there's absolutely no bun on this foot-long, half-pound hot dog.
Literally, oh my goodness.
It looks like just a piece of bread, and then the hot dog is like 10 times bigger than the actual bun.
Yeah, you got like two to 3 inches of like hot dog hanging out of each side of the bun.
That's what she said.
See what you did, HJ? Your story.
Oh my goodness.
She's out here putting all of us guys to shame, too.
Yeah, She's on a roll.
We got to step it up, fellas.
Yes, yeah, you guys have no
what
idea.
What the heck is that?
This is the cleanup.
Is that a sandwich?
Burger. It has.
With a Belgian waffle?
Belgian waffle. You've got golden hash brown potatoes, hickory smoked bacon, and a sunny side up egg.
That sounds good.
Yeah, that sounds pretty damn good. And are those French fries sticking out of it, or what?
Yep.
Yeah.
That's at Truist Park in Atlanta.
Atlanta. The Braves are going all out.
The Marlins have a 34-inch, 2.5-pound sandwich. I don't know who's ordering this and eating it. And
who can afford to pay for that thing?
Yeah, that's got to be.
Feed a family for a week.
Yeah.
The Padres Mexican street corn, that actually sounds pretty good. Hawaiian short rib bowl,
that's the bomb.
The Rockies also came out with like a 2-pound rib, and they called it a dino rib. You literally just get one giant rib. That's one of the new things there,
kind of like a cowboy steak. You ever seen those things?
Yeah, the what are they called? The tomahawk.
Tomahawk.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, like the old tomahawk steaks.
Yeah.
There's a lot of new foods out there. There's the Pittsburgh Pirates released this hot dog called the Renegade. It has pierogies on it, pickles. Mm. Looks like pulled pork.
You can get a pizza in the East Coast with pierogies on top.
That honestly, pierogies are really good.
Yeah, pierogies are good.
The Red Sox came out with these Irish nachos.
Oh, I think we have a picture of the Irish nachos.
Oh, yeah. We'll pull that up for you guys real quick.
Huh.
That's those.
Those ones don't look too bad.
Low quality picture doesn't really do it much justice, but
looks like a salad, Cobb salad or something.
There's just so much on it.
Yeah. It looks like there's waffle fries or.
I love the Aramac flag up there. Like those guys, just they do like rags and like towels and aprons for restaurants. Like
why is that on?
Why
top of the burger?
Why do they have that flag on top of like the mountain of nachos? I don't like. They're not a food company.
Oh, they're not? I thought they were.
No, because when I worked for Noodles, they're the ones they'd always bring us new rags, new aprons. They flip out our carpets, our mop heads.
Maybe they've expanded.
Could have, honestly. We'll give a pretty big deal because all this food is so expensive. There's no way that this is any less than like $6. This s'mores milkshake.
Oh my god,
campfire milkshake. Yeah, is probably like $8.
I think it's probably more than that.
I think it's probably more than that.
It's probably like just anything there is at least $15 to $20.
Yeah, I mean, you buy a burger and it's $18.
Oh yeah, like even just McDonald's nowadays, twice the price. Yeah, you can't.
Most stadiums will sell like piss water, Bud Light for like $10 to $12.
Yeah, they give you a gigantic cup is the only thing. Like the cup is huge. The beer cup is there.
That's true.
But it's like $20 for a beer. But they're so huge, expensive. But still.
Panther piss doesn't taste that good.
Not enough to spend $20 on a beer.
Like you said, CG, it's just ridiculous. You go to the grocery store now, and it's just so expensive. It's just ridiculous.
I don't get it. I don't understand because people aren't making like that much more money. So everybody's just going into hardcore debt, I think.
Yeah, it's just crazy how it's just getting out of control, and we're turning into California. Telling you,
don't say it.
Uh-oh.
Don't say it. We're gonna have mass exodus here in the next 10 years. People are like, man, too crowded in Colorado. I can't handle it.
Yeah.
So, well, that was very enlightening. I might have to make a couple of road trips here, and there are people, and I'm sure you're aware of this, Mercury and CG or Caveman, that do like international trips to go to every stadium, and they've got big maps at their house, and they and it's like, man, I mean, I don't think I'd ever do that, but I would like to go to like Wrigley Field, you know, the big ones.
Fenway. I want to see
I
want to see a game at Madison Square Garden.
Yeah,
that would be nice.
Boston Garden. I mean, just a couple of
I want to try to go to Lambeau Field.
Yes,
that's a classic.
Where's that one at?
Oh, that's Green Bay.
Green Bay
Packers.
Oh,
okay.
They're the only NFL team that's owned by the ticket holders.
Oh, really?
Yep.
Huh. That's neat. I didn't know that.
Yeah. So, yeah, that's definitely on the bucket list.
Yeah, I'd rather just go on a food trip. Now I'm hungry, so I want a hot dog for breakfast.
Stadium food's a good
I did not eat enough breakfast to see all these
exactly.
This morning.
Right. Well, someone smashed on the donuts when I got here. They're like half gone.
Oh, wow. Was it you?
I had one. I had the jelly filled.
It was age before his nap. He was getting ready for his hibernation.
Yeah.
That's what happened. He loaded up on donuts and then had to take
zonked out. Then he got all high on sugar and then he crashed.
What I want to do is take that donut home and make a hot dog, throw it on top of the donut.
Right. Throw some sauerkraut on that thing and some mustard, ketchup.
That's how you pitch it to the Rockies.
That's crazy.
Can you just throw a glazed donut on top of something?
Yeah. Fry up an egg, cook some bacon.
There you go. with a donut bun.
Yeah, make some hash browns, donut on top, donut on the bottom. There you go.
Okay.
Got yourself a balanced breakfast.
I got plans. You're so creative. All of a sudden, I got plans after this.
Right. Throw some, I love when a plan comes together.
Take some of your favorite cereal, throw that in there too. You know, like maybe put it in the top hole.
Well, speaking of cereal, one of the things that I used to do, and I still do, when I was freshly out of the military, is we'd get a big bowl of Apple Jacks and then a big, huge dollop of peanut butter on the side. Oh. And a little peanut butter scoop. And I introduced that to my grandson recently.
Oh, wow.
He's addicted. He's
wow. That's great.
Oh, can I get cereal and peanut butter? But he likes Fruit Loops, so he uses Fruit Loops. But yeah, it's pretty interesting.
He might like that hot dog, actually.
Yeah, he might like that.
Cheese and Fruit Loops. Yeah. Man, that's a kid's dream right there.
That is a kid's dream.
That's an elf. It's an elf food from the movie.
All right.
That's
definitely
something that you can eat.
There. Yeah, right.
I think we're coming up on our next break, folks. We're going to have a music break. And then when we come back, we have a very exciting guest from Adaptive Adventures. His name is Craig DiMartino. He's got a great story. He's got a big heart. Stay tuned. You're not going to want to miss this.
Stronger in the end. life. And I'll never surrender. On this life, and I'll never surrender. On this life, and I'll never surrender. On this life. It's the guts and it's the glory, 100 stripes, 100 stories. It's the Pledge of Allegiance on the 4th of July. It's them handwritten letters from home. It's them sleepless nights alone. It's his newborn baby he left with his wife. Mr. Red, White, and Blue, lay down his life. Mr. Red, White, and Blue, for these stars and stripes. To the swamps of Louisiana, to the golden coast of California, Uncle Sam's the only family he's got. His purple heartbeat won't stop, and his 18th birthday was the day he was born. Mr. Red, White, and Blue, lay down his life.
Welcome back, ladies and gentlemen, to the Revel Experience. We are back in studio. We got CG here, who's, you know, she's been kind of frisky today. I don't know what's going on with her, but man, it's great. She's always entertaining, so it's
nothing wrong with that. It's
but,
just you guys got these topics on point. I just can't be PG.
Yeah, can't resist.
No.
But So without further ado, folks, we have our guest on our show today. His name is Craig DiMartino from Adaptive Adventures. Great guy. I think I've known Craig for, I think, over 10 years. So I don't know if he'll remember when we met, but I believe it was 2013. So I've done a lot of things with Adaptive Adventures. So without further ado, I'm going to turn it over to Craig and kind of let him run with it.
Interview of the week, sponsored by LTD Tactical.
Thank you very much for having me.
Good morning, sir. It's been a while.
I know. It has been a minute. How are you?
Good, man. It's great to hear your voice. You know, I was kind of sharing a little bit of your story with the group here. And I hope, if it's okay with you, that you could share a little bit of that and then just kind of tell us how long you've been with Adaptive Adventures and just the great things that you guys do for people with disabilities, especially veterans.
Sure. I appreciate it. I was actually surprised when you were saying 10 plus years. I think you're right, though. I think it's been 10 or 11 years since we met. So that's been a minute.
It's been a minute, you know, it's been a great, Craig. I mean, you are a consummate professional. You are totally committed to helping veterans and people with disabilities. You're always in a great mood. You're always approachable. So, you know, you've made your wife very proud.
Well, I guess we'll just wrap it up right there then.
Yeah.
No, thank you so much. That's super sweet. I've been a climber most of my life, since pretty much right out of high school, going into college. I started climbing with some friends and climbed. I grew up on the East Coast, so kind of was climbing there, and then came out west to do some climbing in Yosemite, came back through and decided to move out west. And that's actually how I met my wife. I met her in a climbing gym in Philadelphia, and then we connected again back out here in Colorado where we live. And, you know, we climbed together. We had our kids. They climbed, just did our life, and everything was great. And then in 2002, just through a miscommunication with my climbing partner — it wasn't with my wife, Cindy, it was with another good friend — I got accidentally dropped 100 feet. And so, you know, that's basically a 10-story office building, and went off backwards and landed standing, basically straight up and down after the long fall, which completely just destroyed most of my body. My legs were shattered. My back was broke. My neck was broke. My ribs, shoulder, elbow. And that kind of started me on this odd journey, I'll call it. And, you know, started to do the healing thing, stayed in the hospital for about 3 months. They did 11 different surgeries on my right leg. My left leg was in a cast. My back was in a brace. My neck was in a brace. And when I went home, I was just kind of trying to figure out what I wanted to do, if I wanted to climb again, if I wanted to kind of get my life back. And I did. And Cindy and I kind of worked through that together. I kept my leg for about 18 months, and it never got out of a cast. It never healed really well. And so I knew I wanted to go back and try to climb. I just knew wearing a cast probably wasn't going to work long term. So, and it was so mangled and messed up and all this hardware. And so we decided to amputate. And so 18 months after, went in and amputated my leg below the knee. And then that was kind of like the first real good progressive thing I did to kind of get myself back to normal. And about 4 months after that, I was walking and trying to climb again. And that arc was very slow. It was like a really slow buildup. And so just started climbing slowly and doing things and kind of trying to get my body back to where it was. And that took, I mean, no joke, years. It took 2 years probably of me just kind of like slowly chipping away at like what happened after the accident and getting through that.
Getting your head around that. I mean,
yeah, exactly. Like, what does this look like? What does my normal look like? You know, my body was completely different. I mean, obviously missing the leg, lots of scars, lots of busted things that are going to last forever, you know, because you end up with all this chronic pain. But learned how to kind of get a management team or management kind of idea in place that kind of helped me to let me do what I wanted to do. And then kind of was climbing and doing my thing. And a good buddy of mine, I came back from Yosemite, and a good buddy of mine called me up and he said, hey, I'm going to take some veterans who got injured in Iraq climbing. And he's like, I'd love for you to come down and talk with them and climb with them that day. So I went down to Boulder and met these three young guys. They were all in their early 20s, had lost, each of them had lost a limb. I think one of them was actually a double amputee. And we went climbing, and I was pretty reluctant. I wasn't that excited to do it, but my buddy, he's a good friend of mine. And that day just kind of flipped my narrative, because I had never been around amputees that much. I'd never been around veterans that much. And we just had the best day. They were fantastic and so fun to work with, and so excited to be just like doing something active again. And that kind of started me down the road of working with veterans, specifically with physical disabilities. And probably 5 or 6 years after that, I met Chelsea Elder, who is the executive director of Adaptive Adventures, and another guy who's working in their office at the time. They wanted to build a climbing program. So they asked me to write the job description for them. So I was kind of contracting with these other groups to help take people climbing and do things like that. And so I wrote their job description. And when I sent it to them, I said, this would be a really cool job, and I would actually take this job. And so then they kind of laughed and they said, we wanted you to actually see that. So this is a roundabout way of them interviewing me, I guess. So
you passed.
Yeah. And that was, that was 2014 or 13. And so I've been with them for 10 or 11 years now. And we do really cool programs where we're able to take Cindy started working with me about 2 years ago full time. So she and I travel and work with VAs all around the country, and we take veterans out climbing, teach them the quality of life they can have through climbing, kind of get out of their own head. We work with a lot of PTSD folks. We work with a lot of obviously physical disabilities. That's our thing. But the whole idea is that we get them moving again, get them back in a community, and get them outside experiencing nature, experiencing climbing, and showing them how climbing can then influence them positively in their life, and then go from there.
Yeah. Awesome. Yeah. And I've been a recipient of some of those climbs. You know, we've done Clear Creek Canyon several times, and it is awesome, you know, and like you said, you know, chronic pain is just a way of life for a lot of us and for most of us. And, you know, you just got to kind of work through that stuff. And I know I've been experiencing a lot of trouble with my hands lately, so I've been kind of shying away from the climbing, but I'm committed to get back into it. And I was so thrilled to hear that you were back in the United States, because you relocated for a little bit, or what was that all
about? Yeah, we went down. So we were doing programs down in Puerto Rico for about 4 years. And then Cindy and I just stayed down there for about 18 months. And we were doing programs. The VA there is really big, and the island has 300,000 veterans on it. So we had a lot of individuals that we could impact and talk to and work with and kind of get in these programs. And so we had a climbing program running already, and then we started a hiking program as well. So when we go down, Cindy and I now go down probably every quarter and just kind of take them climbing and get them ready to kind of experience that, as well as the hiking program is kind of running with a volunteer of ours down there. And so they meet once a week, but it's an amazing group of individuals. And we wanted to get out of the cold. So living in Colorado in the winter can be a little rough some days. So we kind of selfishly wanted to just stay down there for a while, and that's what we did. So, but been back, we came back, last September. So we've been here about a little over a year now, and it's been lovely to be back.
Mm-hmm. That's awesome.
Yeah.
Yeah. That's definitely, I went to Puerto Rico once while I was in the military, and I've always wanted to get back. So definitely on the list.
It's an amazing island. I mean, we love the people, we love the veterans, we love the way it all looks and feels. And it has some amazing climbing. The first year we went, Adaptive asked us to go down, and I had no idea why we were, I thought it was like a regular Caribbean island that was flat. You know, that's what I was picturing. And it's very mountainous. There's a ton of limestone cliffs. It's beautiful. And that's the only program we have in the country that allows us to climb outside every time. So here in the States, in the winter, obviously we're in the climbing gyms. We generally start the veterans in a climbing gym just to kind of get them used to it. And that's kind of where I think you started too, just to get everyone comfortable and then move them outside. And so it's like a layered process there. The climbing gym is a bouldering only gym, which means there's no ropes. So we don't love that just because of injuries, things like that. So we can start them outside, which is awesome. So they get to experience nature and kind of how healing nature can be, especially when you have a lot going on. You know, you have to, like you just said, Vincente, a lot of them deal with chronic pain. You know, we're all kind of dealing with that in one form or the other. And I think it's really helpful and powerful to know you're not the only person dealing with that. I think sometimes we, you know, we feel like we're the only ones in that particular position. And then you go to these events, you meet these other people, and they're like, oh God, I'm not the only person. It's like, this guy's dealing with it, this woman's dealing with it, we're all dealing with it. So it's like, it's good to feel that community again. It's kind of nice.
It really is. And you know, for me personally, you know, when I see people that are more disabled or more have more challenges than I do, it's a shot in the arm and it's a kick in the ass. Cause I'm like, okay, dude, get out the pity pot.
Yep.
You know, this guy's got no legs, or he's got one arm and one leg or what have you. And he's killing it. So quit feeling sorry for yourself, get out there and immerse yourself in this. And you know, when I see you, Craig, when I see you walk, when I see you climb, dude, I can't tell that you've had this catastrophic injury. It's just amazing. You don't have a limp.
Yeah, I know. It's weird.
You don't have it. I mean, it's amazing. And this guy climbs like a spider. I mean, it's you're inspirational. You're one of my heroes.
Thank you. No, thank you, dude. That's very nice. And that's the powerful thing is, like, I always tell people, like, come to these clinics that we teach or these outings, because it's a perspective builder, right? It's like, perspective is so important to have. And I think a lot of us don't, we get in our little silo, you know, and that's where we are. That's, you don't get out there. Exactly. And so all of a sudden you go into these situations where you're immersed with these other individuals and you're like, oh my God, I'm fine. You know, I'm doing just great. So let's just carry on.
Yeah. So, is there a criteria, Craig, for adaptive ventures? Like, do you have to have a DD214, or you guys need a rating from the VA, or how does that work?
So they don't. So basically the only real, I guess, thing that has to be met is you have to be able to be serviced by the VA, which most individuals are. And then, you just want to come and give us a little bit of background on you. So we kind of do a little bit of questioning about what the disabilities are, what are we going to deal with? And adaptive has 8 different sports. So they can, if climbing is not their thing, you know, they can bike, they can ski, they can water ski, they can drag and boat. There's lots of things they can do. Our mission is just when a person is in the VA and they're in there and they can receive benefits from the VA, we just want to help bring them back into a community of some sort. So whether it's climbing or one of our other sports, we're really trying to just build those communities again. And I think military people really respond to that and enjoy that. So even when we have small groups, like if we have 5 or 6 people, the thing I notice, especially with climbing, and you've experienced this firsthand, is they'll just sit around and talk. You know, they'll just chat, they'll just catch up, kind of get to know each other, because it's a shared experience that not a lot of people have. But all of a sudden now you're around all these individuals who have that same shared experience. So it's quite powerful in and of itself.
Yeah, it is. Cause I mean, you know, there'll be ribbing going on, you know, talking about, you know, you're in the army. Oh, don't start to hear that. Or oh, I was in the Air Force. Or, but like you said, it always comes back to that mutual respect, that camaraderie.
Yep.
And you just see them light up like candles. You really do. You just see people just, you know, and like you said, they leave in a completely different state of mind. They're just, you know, they're happy, you know, for the most part, everybody had a great time and it's a memorable experience.
Right. And it's repetition too. We try to get people to not do like a one-off. We try to get them, if they come out, we want them to kind of continue to come out, because these services, we get Adaptive Adventures gets an adaptive sport grant each year. And that's an incredibly important thing, because the federal government recognizes that these activities should be happening to get veterans active again, to get them back in community. And so because of that grant, all of these programs are free to veterans and their caregivers and family. So the veteran can come with their, like in your case, like your grandkids have been in the climbing stuff. And that I think is really important, because when I was hurt, I had a really strong support network around me. I had my family, had my friends, had the climbing community. And I think we want to honor that. We want to make sure that those people know that we know what goes on behind the scenes. It's not just that veteran or that patient. We understand that it's more than that. And so we want to help support that any way we can. So these programs are free. They just have to basically get to the location that we're working in, and then everything is taken care of for them.
So, yeah, that's some powerful stuff there. So speaking of that, of being memorable, what would be, you would consider your most memorable moment that you've been dealing with in the last, you know, that you've experienced in the last 10 years?
Oh my gosh.
We have many of them, but
yeah, so many. I am so, I think, fortunate just to know that we get to meet and impact these lives in some way. And probably one of the things that bubbles up as you ask that is the veteran that we have who runs our climbing program in Puerto Rico. I mean, he has told us on many occasions that these programs have saved his life. He was suicidal. He has massive amounts of anxiety and PTSD from his time in the military. And he said, you know, I just was at the end. I just didn't know what else to do. And we met, we took him climbing. He was deathly afraid of climbing when he started with us. And now he's a wonderful climber. He does fantastic outside. He leads these hiking programs for us in Puerto Rico, and his life has been just revamped completely. You know, he has a wonderful wife, he has a wonderful family, and he's able to see that, you know, he's not alone. That's what he was feeling. He was just completely isolated, and he just felt like he was, you know, nothing else to live for. And then all of a sudden he meets just a couple people, and we just happen to be there at the right place, right time to kind of introduce him to these things. And man, his life has just completely turned around, which I think we get to see that a lot. And it's, I try to never lose sight of how important that is. That's just so powerful to me and Cindy.
Yeah, it is critical because, you know, a lot of us, if not most of us, get out of the military and we lose our purpose. And so one of the huge benefits of these programs is giving veterans a purpose again in their life, something that they can delve into and wake up in the morning, have a purpose to wake up in the morning and to continue to forge ahead. Because I was in the same boat. I think 2015, 2016 was the worst years of my life. I was, you know, I had suicidal ideation. I was tempted a couple times, and I was in the mental ward probably a dozen times. And this little lady, I couldn't even tell you her name. She doesn't work there anymore, but she worked in the rec therapy department, and her job was to go to the hospital and talk to veterans about the rec therapy program. And I think I cussed her out probably 10 times. Told her to get the hell out of my room. And she kept that, bless her heart, she's kept coming back. And so just one day I was like, you know what? All right, just to shut you up, I'll do it. And I went and it did change my life. I mean, it's literally saved my life, these programs. That get you involved, that keep you active, that give you a purpose. They're just so critical. And I feel like they're highly underutilized. I really do. I think there's a lot of veterans that are stuck still, and they're just not, you know, I mean, I've seen people and, you know, they have a great time and then I never see them again. So it's like,
right.
You know, that's sad, but you know, we just keep forging ahead and hoping that we can, you know, affect people's lives in a positive manner. So now moving on to my next question there, Craig. Let's see. I'm trying to decipher this chicken scratch. So what is your official title right now?
I have a really, it sounds very important. It's just not that important though. My title for Adaptive is National Climbing Manager. Is that right? National Climbing Manager. Which that just means I travel a lot to the different VAs around the country and Puerto Rico and Hawaii. So we have local programs. So here in Colorado, when we're here, we have programs up and down the Front Range. And those happen roughly once a month in different locations. So they can kind of go and see what we're doing on our website, which is adaptiveadventures.org. And then we travel. And so that national piece comes in when we hit all these different VAs all around the country, because each VA has a rec therapy unit usually, and we just plug into that unit, and as a vetted organization with the VA, we're able to work wherever the VA is. So it's great. We try to hit underserved communities as much as we can. We understand that a lot of people in those areas don't have a lot of services, so we want to help to provide that, and being mobile allows us to do that. So we have me as a national climbing manager, we have a national paddle manager, bike manager, things like that. So we can kind of attack it in all these different sports, all these different forms all around the country.
Awesome. And so what do you see yourself in long term, like with your position at Adaptive Adventures? What do you see yourself?
I you know what's funny, Vincente? I keep getting asked this, which is hysterical. It must mean I'm getting old. Chelsea was just like, what are you doing? Like, what are you gonna do like in the next 5 years or so? And to me, Cindy and I joke about this all the time. We would be doing what we're doing whether we were getting paid or not. So we've been climbers our whole life, and so it's, we would be doing this anyway. So I think I'm just going to keep doing what I do for as long as I can do it, and then, you know, phase out of it and bring in somebody who's younger and, you know, able to do these things that I don't just physically want to do anymore. But like, man, I love doing what I do. I love introducing climbing to these people. I love climbing. So for me, it's, I'm just going to keep doing what I do.
Yeah, and it definitely shows. I mean, like I said, if you guys ever get the CG or an H train, you guys get the opportunity to meet Craig and see what he does best. It definitely shows. I mean, he's just on point. I never had an experience with Craig where he wasn't on point. I mean, he's just, you know, he's always in a great mood.
Thank
he's
you.
Like making sure you get what you need. Your needs are being met. So my kudos to you.
Thank you. Thank you.
Can you tell us a little bit about the founding of Adaptive Adventures and the logo and all that and how it came about?
Yeah, Adaptive started, this is actually our 25th year. So they started 25 years ago. Two good friends were both disabled. One was in a wheelchair, one was an amputee. And they just wanted to get their veteran friends together and do something. And so they started with a houseboat on Lake Powell. And that was the first like trip that they did. And this, it went really well. And so they did that, I guess, a second year. And then they were both skiers. And so they decided they wanted to have ski programs where, again, like all of our sports, it was just, this is what I do and I want to share this with somebody else. And so they started ski programs. Ski programs led to bikes, to paddling, to climbing. And so over the past 25 years, it has gone, at the biggest, we had like 11 different sports. And then we kind of narrow that down to like the 8 core sports that we all kind of love to do. And they're that, it's basically just the outdoor sports, if you think about it. Started doing traveling more. That's probably about 12 years ago, kind of right when I came in. They started to really kind of blossom out and do more as far as like what they do nationally. So the founders have retired. They're still, you know, connected to us, but they're not doing anything with us. They come to some special events we do. And then the logo, we just redid the logo probably right before COVID, we redid the logo, which is now, it's more, I think, updated. It feels more kind of contemporary and more in jive with what we do. And so it's an arrow now that has, it's like an arrow in within an A that kind of shows the upward progression that we always aim for. And then that transfers, each sport kind of has its own sport specific logo that goes with it. So we've been very happy to be doing what we're doing. And I think Chelsea would tell you this too. I think in the last probably 3 years is when we really feel like we dialed into like what we should be doing and how we should do it exactly. Because we see the success that it brings, and we see that we try to get that, like kind of what you touched on, is that one-off where the veteran comes in, does it one time, and then doesn't come back. We've learned like, okay, we don't like that. We want them to be engaged over time, and that's where they'll be able to heal. But I think that's a progression that you have to learn as you go. And I feel like we finally have figured out like, okay, this is how we get repeat customers, as well as bring in new people to kind of come to these events that we're doing. So always evolving, always learning, hopefully, and changing, and trying to help as many people as we can.
Yeah, because I mean, I've been to many events with different nonprofits, and you know, you meet people, you have a great time, and you exchange information, and it's a trudge, dude. You know, to maintain those friendships for whatever reason. You know, I think at least once a month, I'll just go through my phone list and just start dialing numbers and
that's awesome.
See who answers. Yeah,
that's awesome.
But you know, it is, and again, you know, we do tend to get in our own little funk, and we do tend to isolate. So, you know, if we can save one life, if we can get one veteran out there doing something that they've never done before, get them out of their comfort zone, it's well worth it. So that's, you know, the kind of why we do what we do, and you know, and you do what you do. So, you know, it's very noble work, but it's also very gratifying. So what are the 8 core sports that you guys do? So rock climbing,
skiing, water skiing, biking, stand up paddle boards, dragon boat. I always forget. Oh, climbing. And, I always forget the last sport, and I'm blanking on it again. So, I'll think about that and it'll come to me.
Pickleball. Sure. Yeah.
Yeah. It should be pickleball. God, I love that.
All the rage right now.
I know, right?
Sport. Yeah.
That's right. It's an outdoor sport. We could do that.
Yeah. And when you say, you know, cause I'm a huge mountain biker. So is it just road cycling?
So they do road and gravel.
Okay. Road and gravel.
Chris Wiegand is our bike guy, and he does, and they do a lot of riding. It's amazing what they do, but I think right now they stick with gravel, and I think mountain biking has been talked about, but we haven't done it yet. Just, okay. You know, the bikes that they have, they literally take a huge trailer wherever they go. And they have like 60 or 70 bikes in this thing, all adaptive in one way or another. So all the way from trikes to regular seated 2-wheel bikes, but you have to be able to outfit for everything. And so if you had to do that, then you'd have a whole other fleet just for mountain biking. So right now they have this huge trailer that they truck around. And again, they hit 30 some states a year as well, where they're taking this trailer, teaching people how to ride, teaching, you know, like Chris always says, you know, bikes aren't just exercise, they're a form of freedom. And I think a lot of our sports do that. It gives you, the veteran, a chance to be like free of whatever's holding them back and feel like they're alive again. And I think biking is one of the easiest ways. It's so, as a kid, you know, everybody loves to learn to ride a bike. And even we have some veterans who never learned to ride a bike. And so they start them off right there, and they teach them how to do that. They work them up. And so again, most of our sports are progressive. So, you know, we start them in one zone and then we move them. We want them to be progressing and moving towards something better and new. And so that's another way to do that. So that's just another vehicle, if you will, to get them to kind of grow and be part of a community.
Yeah, that's awesome. And that's so true. Cause you know, we take a lot of things for granted. Oh, everyone's ridden a bike, or everyone knows how to, you know, stand up paddle, you know, and I did that a couple years ago, man. That's no joke, dude.
That is not easy, man. I'm convinced that's done with mirrors because
yeah, it's not, dude, that is no joke, man. I struggled.
I know. I had somebody they were totally joking with us because they said, they were watching me try to paddleboard, and they said, I've never seen somebody who can do one sport really well and be so bad at another one. That's me. 100%. Very much a one trick pony.
Yeah. Cause I've talked to Craig about doing some winter sports, and he's like, no, I don't ski. I don't do any of that stuff. So.
Yep.
I'm a rock climber, so
that stuff's hard, man. That stuff is hard.
Yeah. So, and then you tell us a little more about your family. So you have two boys, is that right?
I have a girl, a boy and a girl. And so daughter lives in, currently living in Washington State, but is just got accepted into a grad program. So we'll be moving to Montana. And then our son is here on the Front Range with us. He's going to CSU. But lives in near the school in Fort Collins. So he's up there. And then my wife and I, Cindy, have been married for almost 28 years now. So awesome. Been together a long time, which is, and she's like my best friend. So she does all the programs with me. She's actually the brains of the operation. I have no idea how we didn't screw this up beforehand, because that was me doing the planning, which is terrifying. So when Cindy started working with us about,
she saved you.
Yeah. Oh my God, dude, she's totally saved me. She stepped in, and now there's actually organization. There's actually like a calendar. What an idea. So
she's like, no, we're not doing that. We're doing this today. Remember, yeah. I told you yesterday.
Exactly. And I'm the big picture logistics person. I can get anyone climbing, but like, man, ask me to plan something and write it down and forget it. So Cindy's been an amazing addition to our team.
Was she there when you had your accident?
She wasn't with me. I was climbing again. I was climbing with a good friend of ours, but then Cindy was there. Our kids were really young. They were 2 and 4 when I got hurt. So she was, she had run a long, I think it was a 50K race in Leadville. And so was resting at home and then got a phone call from my climbing partner as they were evacuing me down the kind of Taliesin rocks to get me to a trail. He called her and said, hey, Craig broke his ankles. He didn't tell her how bad I was hurt. He just said he broke his ankles. And so she, another friend came over, stayed with our kids, and she hightailed it up to where I got hurt. And then obviously was with me the rest of the way, but she didn't see me get hurt, but then saw obviously that the aftermath of it all.
Yeah. And so did I hear you right? You said you're moving to Montana?
No, my daughter is.
Oh, your daughter is.
Okay. Yeah. No. I love Montana. I love Montana.
We went there a couple years ago and it's beautiful.
It's gorgeous. And I mean, the program that they're going into is fantastic. And we actually started a program in Bozeman just this winter and we'll start one in Missoula. So we'll be able to kind of visit when we get up there. But that there's a really large veteran contingent up there. And we just want to, we have not tapped into it very much at all. Just started to scratch the surface in Bozeman. So we'll see what we can kind of expand to now.
Yeah. My wife was a huge Yellowstone fan.
Oh,
the show. And so yep. I said, honey, you know, this is not filmed in Montana, right? so she made me book a trip out there. We went out there a couple years ago for a week to Fairmont Hot Springs.
Yep.
Beautiful. And it's a different kind of cold in Montana, man.
It is.
God, you better be prepared, man. We went there in August, and you know, we were it's summertime, you know, we don't need jackets. So we had to go buy jackets.
Yep. Wow. They don't actually get summer, I don't think. I think their summer is like our fall.
Yeah,
it gets exactly. A little bit chilly up there, but definitely gorgeous place.
Beautiful. Yep. Well, Craig, it's been a huge pleasure. You know, it's
thank
always nice
so
to
much.
See you again.
Always good.
I want to get back in the loop. I was talking to Chelsea the other day. She's like, dude, we haven't seen you. Where you been? And
I know. So
I need to get back in the loop, and I will definitely make that a point of doing that. But we really appreciate you taking out of your busy day. I know you wear a lot of hats. And visiting with us today, and don't forget, folks, Adapted Adventures. You know, check them out on the web, and they've got some great programs for all you veterans out there. And again, our last segment there, Craig, is your time to shine. So it's kind of something we maybe didn't talk about, or something that you want that's near and dear to your heart.
I think really just.
Sorry, had a little intro there.
No, you're good. That's good. I wasn't ready.
Got to have Carlton, you know.
I know. God, I haven't seen that in a minute. I think really what I want anyone to always hear is that they're not alone doing whatever they're doing. Whatever they're feeling, you know, it's a very fluid situation. And I tell people all the time, just come out. Just you don't have to say I'm going to climb. You don't have to say I'm going to ride or do any of the other things. Just come out and hang out with the group of people, because that will hopefully spur you into doing what we're doing at that particular instance. But I feel like people think, oh, I can't do this or I can't do that. I know doctors, I was in the same predicament where they're telling you one thing, you should listen to that. But you should also have people like us out there saying, I understand what is going on, but you can also be doing these other things. And we can do it safely. We can do this with you actually like prospering and flowering and doing really well on these things. So if it's not climbing, come check us out, adaptiveadventures.org, and kind of see where you can plug in. And if you feel like none of these sports work, just come and hang out with the community and just get to meet some new folks and maybe just realize you're not alone, that there are other people dealing with the same stuff.
Yeah, definitely. And I'm glad you told me about the water skiing. I think I'll have to look into that as well.
There you go. There you go.
I haven't done that in a minute, but I used to love to do it, you know, when I was a younger, more virile man. But
I love it.
But yeah, we really appreciate you, Craig. Thanks so much for hanging out with us. And we will talk soon. Have a great day. And take care, my friend.
Thank you. We'll see you soon.
All right. Bye.
Take care. Bye.
Bye.
All right. That was an awesome interview. I just feel so good after an interview because these people just pour their hearts out and they're just dedicated to what they do and they love veterans. And, you know, it's always neat when you have a fellow veteran that's involved in one of these nonprofits. But when you see these, you know, civvies, we call them, these civilians that have just are totally committed to helping people that have disabilities. And again, especially veterans, it just blows me away because they feel truly indebted to giving back to the veterans. And as you guys know, it hasn't always been that way. I mean, our Vietnam veterans had it really, really bad. And some other folks that didn't get the kind of programs or even the respect that we get today. And, you know, I hope to God this bubble doesn't burst. Cause you know, I know how we kind of were cyclical mm-hmm. in our society, but yeah. So when I see civilians that really just give of themselves and are dedicated and focused on helping veterans, it's very impressive.
Yes, it is. It
warms the cockles of my heart. So anyway, let's see where we're running at. Okay.
9:30.
Well, let's take a little music break, and then when we come back, we'll have our final thoughts. Oh, tribute to the troops.
Sir, I don't know how to tell this story.
Well, you got to, Joe. You tell the American people what these men did here. You tell them how my troopers died.
Hello, everyone. Thank you for tuning in to MBR today as we pay tribute to Army Sergeant First Class John David Randolph Hilty, 44 of Bowie, Maryland, who died March 30, 2020. Hilty was assigned to 1st Battalion, 227th Aviation Regiment, part of the 1st Cavalry Division out of Fort Hood, Texas. Hilty joined the Army in April of 1999 as a combat engineer. All of us here at MBR would like to thank you, Sergeant First Class Hilty, for your service and dedication to our country. Our thoughts and prayers are with your family, friends, and those who served alongside. Rest easy, brother.
Been home about 6 months now, and I still have my doubts. Well, I'm not sure how I got here or how I'm gonna get out. Well, my mama says I look the same as I did before I left, but if she could see inside of me, it would scare her to death. I can still taste the powder from the barrel of my gun, and I can hear my sergeant screaming, "Run, soldier, run!" And I can feel the backpack on my shoulders, got it weighed a ton, and I see death in every single thought. Well, they taught me how. Put that uniform on, I just can't get it off. Last Saturday they honored us in a small parade downtown, and when they shot off those fireworks, I nearly hit the ground. And while they smiled and cheered for us. All I could do was stare, 'cause part of me is here at home, but part of me is back there. Well, I can still taste the powder from the barrel of my gun, and I can hear my sergeant screaming, run, soldier, run. Feel the backpack on my shoulders, got it weighed a ton. And I see death in every single fall. They taught me how to put that uniform on. I just can't get it on. Yeah, there's no end in sight, 'cause even though I'm home, still fighting for my life. Well, I can still taste the powder from the barrel of my gun, and I can hear my sergeant screaming, run, soldier, run. And I can feel the backpack on my shoulders, got it weighed a ton. They taught me how to put that uniform on. I just can't get it off. Well, the devil's won some battles, and he may win some more, but don't he know the American soldier will always win.
Welcome back, ladies and gentlemen, to the Revel Experience. We're here live in the studio. We've got CG with her whole clan. We've got H Train. He's not feeling good. He's probably gonna have to admit him into the hospital. Just saying. And we got Caveman and HG in the background doing their thing.
Sound.
Great interview today. What'd you guys think?
Yeah, he was really cool. Really good. It was a great story. What
an amazing story. Yeah,
that's awesome.
Yeah, he's a heck of a guy.
Only imagine how difficult of a choice that was to eventually like be like, yeah, I gotta amputate my leg.
Mm-hmm.
But I mean, he came back stronger than ever. So he's doing some great stuff for the world.
Yeah, you know, and I'm a firm believer, and I don't want to get spiritual, but I'm a firm believer in things happen for a reason, and it kind of steered his life into this life of giving back. And it's, you know, he's just very happy, and him and his wife love what they do. And I don't think they ever dreamed, you know, 10, 15 years ago, that they would be able to do something they love and in the process, enrich the lives of others, you know. So,
with a disability, because
a disability, you know, yeah. He's a fellow disabled person, and you know, so he knows exactly what a lot of us are going through, and
yeah, that's he could. Definitely relate with people more, you know, that's really positive.
And you know, well, he talked about a support team, and that is so huge. I mean, I have a beautiful wife that I've been married to for 35 years, and my kids and my extended family, and you know, they are so critical in my recovery, and I'm just grateful every day that I have them, and you know, all the crap that I've put them through. And it's like last night my little granddaughter told me, Bumpo, you're a handful.
Oh, that's so cute.
So I was like, you're right, I am a handful. She's like, but I love you, Bumpo. I'm like, I love you too, baby. So
sweet.
We did a little video. I was supposed to be doing videos prior to our guest speaker, you know, each week. And so H made me do it yesterday, and she had to chime in. She had to come over and steal the show. And so, yeah, it's great being, I love being a grandparent. So, but yeah, great interview. Another great show. So let's just, we'll just go right into our final thoughts, and we'll start with you, CG.
5, 4, 3, 2, 1, 1. We have ignition. Strap in.
It's the 2-minute warning.
2-minute warning.
What we learned today.
Are you not entertained? Are you not entertained?
Sponsored by Freedom Balls at checkout. Make sure you put an M Radio for 10% off.
Well, I learned that the Rockies suck, I guess.
That is true.
I don't follow sports too much, but I know we've had our winners, but I didn't realize the Rockies were.
They're not one of them.
No.
Their first game of the season was
they're in the bottom of the barrel, huh?
Yeah, the Diamondbacks were the runner-up in the World Series, so not the best. Not the best first game to have.
It was essentially like a tune-up game for the Diamondbacks, which is, you usually only see that like on like a collegiate level where it's some like really good program just plays like a Division II school, just beats the snot out of them to get their players feeling good. Like you don't usually see that at the pro level, but that's what happened to the Rockies.
I thought that opening day wasn't until like next week.
At least not here. It was in Arizona.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, so the home opener, yeah.
Oh, the home opener. Gotcha. Yeah. Okay.
Yeah, so, you know, and it makes you kind of just, man, I'm really missing 2007.
I know.
You know, and I think they won, what, like 19 games in a row to make it to the World Series. And, yeah, who cares? We got swept by the Red Sox. But still, that was such a great year. And, you know, we've had a couple of flashes in the pan since there, but it's been pretty abysmal since. For the most part,
yeah,
they might lose 100 games this season.
Yeah,
they already did that last year.
Yeah, it's not looking back good.
Not looking good. All right, Caveman, you're up.
I learned this a lot about our interview, the Adaptive Adventures. Last week, when we were talking to our interview, he said that there wasn't really as much equipment for, you know, when they went on their hunting stuff. But it seems like since he is also like a disabled guy as well, he has the ways to get resources through like his own like help that he's gotten through his injury. So they're able to get like a lot of good equipment. They said they had the whole fleet of bikes.
Oh, wow. Yeah. Go.
That was all different types of adaptive, you know, ridability.
Yeah, it's a quick, you know, the keyword in their name too. So,
yeah.
You know. Yeah, you know, and you know, some nonprofits like Adaptive Ventures are more, how would I put that, are just more plugged in with the VA, and they get a sizable amount of grant money versus, you know, other nonprofits that have to, you know, have donors or, you know, do other types of grants and stuff. So they do have a lot of resources, and they do have a lot of financial backing. So that's good. I wish we could spread that around more with other nonprofits, but it is what it is. MBR is delving into that. You know, I'm kind of spearheading that movement, and it's an arduous process, man, filling out grant applications and making sure you're wording it right and everything. So it is what it is.
But, did you ask AI to do it for you?
You know, the one we did this week was pretty simplistic comparatively. So, but yeah, I have another one I'm going to do for the VA. You know, it's a government one. The government ones definitely got to use AI because they are so complicated. But H-Train suggested that, and I said, I think that's a great idea.
Mm-hmm.
All right. See, HG, you're up.
All right. Well, first, I don't know how you guys keep getting AI to do all this stuff for you. I keep like DMing him on all of his social medias, and he won't answer. So I don't know how everybody else can get a hold of Allen Iverson, but I can't. So
he's old school, man. You're a young buck, so he might not.
I guess that's why. Yeah. So if you
keep trying, just keep plugging away.
It's nice to see that he's back in the news.
Yeah, next time you talk to him, like, can you put in like a good word for me? Like, I hear he's doing all this great stuff for people. Like, I want to. I don't know how he does it, but. Actually, I learned a lot about North Carolina today. You guys have some pretty extensive knowledge of the great state.
Yeah.
And so I felt like
South Carolina, actually.
Oh, yeah. South Carolina. Yeah.
The Carolinas.
The Carolinas, yeah.
In general. Yeah. So it sounds like a very intriguing land. I kind of, you guys were talking about them, like, I kind of want to go.
Yeah, it's a nice place.
Go visit.
Yeah, it's gorgeous. It's Yeah, it's really
and
nice.
You know, I recommend it. I'm not sure about South Carolina, but North Carolina is still pretty reasonable.
Yeah, no, they're living. Yeah, the South Carolina same. The housing market is really, you can get a big house for what, you know, you'd pay for 1,000 square foot here.
Wow. Yeah.
Yeah. So they're,
and they have cheap green fees. So, so what I learned today is that, that there's just so many great programs out there that need more utilization, and there's just awesome people. You know, I have pretty extensive experience with a lot of different nonprofits, and I've yet to meet a person that's involved with that nonprofit that isn't pleasant, that isn't bending over backwards to meet your needs and to making sure that all your needs are addressed. And so, you know, my hat's off to them, and they do tireless work, and they should be commended. I don't think they get the recognition they deserve. So I would implore any veteran to reach out to us or to one of the nonprofits in Colorado or elsewhere. There's great ones all over the nation, and take that chance. You know, take that chance, dive in, and try something new. You know, it could definitely save your life, like it saved my life. So we don't want to forget to mention our sponsors: Freedom Balls, LTD Tactical, Sky Blue Radio, Basic Radio, DV Radio, Dunkin' Donuts. We have Dunkin' Donuts to thank for my high cholesterol, and Jersey Mike's. And I'm sorry, what does that say? James Harrison? Okay.
Arska.
James Arska. We appreciate all of you for your continued support. And we are in debt to everybody that helps MBR Radio. And, you know, H-Train just shared with me, we are featured in the VA, in a VA article about 3 weeks ago, and we got inundated with emails and people that want to, you know, take up the podcasting training that he offers. And he revealed to me that he's got 7 shows since then. 7.
Wow.
That's huge.
I mean, one of them is mine.
Yeah, one of them is CG's.
Time to plug it. Yeah.
Yeah. So that's awesome. That 50 is 50 so
States
cool.
of Gray.
50 and States. Tell us a little more about that.
Yeah. So it's a travel podcast, but also for, I have 3 different segments. And the final segment is, it's called Explore. It's like Hometown Explore. So I'm talking to vets throughout the 50 states. So we're going to try and peel away like every state, have like a map and, you know, put a little pin in it and try and get vets to sell us on their state. Why? What are they, you know, good restaurant, whatever they have, you know, get more of a hometown advice rather than a travel, you know, advice that's very general, very like, you know, 6 flags and that's it.
Yeah.
Type
yeah,
stuff. I want to, you know, the vets to tell us what makes their town special, you know, like outside of what you normally would just find if you went to TripAdvisor or something.
Yeah, exactly. It's a firsthand experience that people that live there and actually, you know, know. Because, you know, it's funny because if you do talk to a local and they say, don't go here, don't go there, let me tell you what you do.
Yeah, listen to them.
Where to go. Yeah, you listen to them and you end up having a great time. So, yeah,
we got that debut show tonight at 8. Time.
Oh yeah, yeah. Our friends,
our buddies, Doug and Mike. And Mike.
Oh, nice.
Hard way, it's not bourbon and ball. It's
bourbon. Bourbon and ball.
Yeah, bourbon and ball. So the
drink a little bourbon. Starting the night. Baseball.
So, oh, okay.
So if anybody caught the show me and K-Man did a couple weeks ago, we had them on as like some special guests. They
it was their little debut. We got to know them a little bit. It was our second interview after we interviewed your friend Thomas. But we got them on.
They're pretty excited. Yeah, they're, awesome. Like H was saying, their show is going to be tonight, 8 a.m. Eastern or 8 p.m. Eastern time. They just sit bourbon, talk baseball. They're big fantasy baseball guys. So if you like baseball, definitely. These are the guys to be with because they really know their stuff. Even Norton being Caveman, like we're more football basketball guys.
They're pretty
expertise.
Are they wasted by the end of the podcast?
Yeah, I mean, are they hammered? do they plow through a handle or what's going on?
They usually...
Usually at the end of 2 hours.
Three drinks.
Yeah, okay. I like how you said sipping, so that's good. You know. Yeah. And are they out of Colorado?
They are in the East Coast.
They're actually. East Coast. And the bourbon they like of choice is the Horse Soldier Bourbon. It's a distillery that's run by the... I believe it's the soldiers that they had to ride like the horseback into was it Afghanistan, Iraq? They like invaded on horseback.
Oh yeah.
So
I think that was Iraq.
Yeah, it was like that group of soldiers. The guys that came home and opened their own bourbon distillery, so that's their bourbon choice. Nice. Really,
that's pretty cool.
Really great show. Cool. Yeah. So they're
cool.
We're stoked for it. Yeah. These guys are. I mean, they really love their. Know their stuff and love what they're talking about, so you should definitely tune in and check them out as well.
So do you guys you know, being a sports show yourself, do you guys collaborate with other, like, will you collaborate with these guys? Do you guys like ask advice, get pointers?
Oh yeah.
Yeah. We were the ones that helped them get set started. Up initially, and we were just talking to them and helping get some of the finer points of their show tuned out.
We met with them over like a Google Meet.
Yeah, but they got a lot of the great segments, and yeah, you know, like I said, you can really tell they're very passionate about what they're talking about, and it's infectious, you know.
Mm-hmm.
Listening to their you know, their first like their first test segments that they did, where they were working out, you know, the sample segments they sent to us, like I was, you know, they got you invested.
Nice.
So that's good. Another great show. Everybody should tune in tonight. 8 p.m. Eastern to check them out, and we're talking with them. We might do, since we're both sports shows, we might do some collaborations down the line once they get their show up and running. They also like to do fantasy football, so we're thinking about
making a
fantasy football league here between all the NBR radio DJs. Nice.
That's a good idea.
If people want to get involved in that,
you guys
but
do that next season.
We got a ways to go with fantasy football before that's a thing. But
yeah.
Do you guys participate every year in that?
Yeah,
usually every year.
Huge fantasy football junkie. I did like 5 leagues last year. So
The football is a lot easier to manage than your baseball, just from hearing them explain it. You have to draft so many more players for baseball.
It's so much of a longer season that, you know, you have guys that will take like long stretches where they got to take time off and they're not playing, so then you have to have reserves for those guys, and it's.
I know what we forgot to do. Open the browser and go to.
So
we have that backpack to give away
today. Oh, okay.
Backpack.
Okay.
Our little...
Well, all right, we got it. I almost took that yesterday, so I'm glad you're. I was gonna give it to my granddad.
He saw you eyballing it.
Right.
He knew. He's like, yeah, we gotta actually give this. Woo. Kobe.
That is a nice one. Operation Good Boy.
Yeah, there you go.
That is cool.
See our winner, everyone.
Yep. So now we go over to
finished.
Who is the winner?
Drum roll, please.
So
a long drum roll.
Yeah.
Go ahead and pick the picker.
Which one?
One winner.
Winner unpicked.
Draw winner.
Here we go.
Oh,
here we go.
Wow.
Very long drum roll.
That's neat.
Okay, draw.
All right. The website's a little slower.
Yeah.
Slower than your drumming.
than we thought. I'm still giving the drum roll.
It's not showing us. Export winners.
Oh, we won. Yay!
What are the odds?
It's not rigged. It's not rigged. There we go. We got it.
Victoria. Tillerson.
Victoria Tillotson. Looks like you won our backpack.
All right.
So
congratulations, Victoria, on winning
Victoria
the backpack.
Victoria Tillotson. Very good. Well, all right. Well,
congratulations.
This is a nice little bag, a little travel bag, like a shoulder bag.
Yeah, a little crossbody.
Yeah, that is cool. That would work great with my Snuggo.
Oh, what's this?
I think
you could put your phone maybe there. I don't know. That's
neat. Strap it to your belt, maybe.
Yeah, possibly.
Keep it more stable. Yeah, so this is a pretty nice bag. Here, take a look at it. It's got a little strap and a bunch of little pockets. It's got the Operation Good Boy logo on it, which is great.
Yeah, it's like a
products.
Nice material.
Yeah, like it's kind of like military grade
yeah,
stuff.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
So that's pretty nice. Very nice. Congratulations, Victoria.
Nice.
There we go. And then the winner got announced on the website, so I think they will get a notification.
That's true, yeah.
Okay.
Cool.
Yeah, yeah, we'll let you know. That'll be coming there soon. That's cool, though.
That is cool.
We're giving that one away.
Nice.
This month went by so quick.
I know, right?
Oh, that's why this already.
It just gets worse, dude. When you get older, it just flies by. It's like, wow, I can't believe it. You know, unless your son moves back home, then it goes slow as a snail's pace.
Dang. No more naked Fridays.
No, clean up all the pecker jacks.
Just don't cook bacon when you're.
Well, folks, thanks for joining us today. We had a great show as usual. It's just a pleasure to talk with our nonprofits, to be enlightened by my crew here and my co-host and H Train and CG and our HG and Caveman. Stay tuned. We will be back next week with an all new show. Got a new speaker. I can't remember what we have next week. Oh, who is that? Is that Operation Beethoven? Or yeah. So thanks for joining us today, folks. We had a great time. And we hope that you enjoyed the show. So have a wonderful week, and we'll see you next time.
Bye-bye.
Yeah, empowering veterans from all walks of life by giving veterans a voice.
That's the show for today, everyone. Thanks for listening. We'll be back next week with an all-new show. And remember, you can listen to us again and again. The podcast of this radio show is available right after we go off the air tonight, anywhere that you can get your podcast episode.